ellipsis, which looks somewhat like underline codes, and we can tell at a glance that the word R will be underlined. Moving to the word sum, let's insert superscript codes and see what they look like. Plus begin, plus end. Escaping back out, you can see that superscript is now an up arrow. Logically enough, subscript is a down arrow. If we press Control B for boldface, it's not quite as obvious since we can't change the text on the screen, but we put a vertical line on each side of the word in order to highlight it and enhance it as being a bold. The print date option, or print time, let's insert the print date, and you can see it as an hourglass conveying that concept of printing a date or printing a time. The same code is used for both since we have a limited number of formatting options available to us.
Now we're going to look at some of the features of the spreadsheet. The first one we'll examine is one of my personal favorites, which we call 3D. The D is simply for dimension, three dimension meaning being able to refer to cells inside of another spreadsheet from the current spreadsheet. The best way to see this is to look at an example. If you look at the screen, you'll notice at the top highlighted the word Cheyenne for the city of Cheyenne. This deals with a record owner who has several shops. You'll notice female vocalists and male vocalists for which he's keeping track. He has two other shops, one in Los Angeles and one in Nashville. It's very logical for him to put these different shops inside of different files. However, now comes the end of the month and it's time for him to see how each of his three shops did. And he'd like to see this in a consolidated fashion. Let's look at a consolidated spreadsheet. Consolidated, and now notice that we've set it up so that we can see for three cities, Cheyenne, Los Angeles, and Nashville, underneath each of his categories, female vocalists and male vocalists. Observe the highlighted formula. Inside the quotes is Cheyenne, a string of text, followed by a colon, followed by B7. The colon signifies that Cheyenne is a file name and that we are looking for cell B7 in the file Cheyenne. The highlighted cell gives us 35. Let's check that. Let's go back to Cheyenne, look at cell B7, and sure enough, it has a 35 in it, the total of the female vocalists. Changing that a moment to 16 gives us a total of 36. Going back to our consolidated spreadsheet, let's recalculate it, and sure enough, we change from 35 to 36. All of these cells contain 3D imports. Another feature of 3D is that we do not need to use a string to give us our file name. Rather, we can use another cell coordinate to provide the file name. In this example, we have a summary of these record shops by city. He didn't want the detail of who the female vocalists were. Rather, he only wanted to know the totals. Let's do an OpenApple K to update this. First of all, he wanted to see Cheyenne. He was satisfied. Then he said, no, let's look at Los Angeles. Simply type in Los Angeles, Los Angeles, and it automatically recalculates and shows us the totals for Los Angeles. Let's look at one of these formulas. Notice again at the bottom of the screen what the formula is, the colon and the B7. But to the left of the colon, rather than a file name, we simply have the cell coordinate A1. Which contain the Los Angeles at the top. Let's look at one other. Let's see how our Nashville store is doing. And there we have it. We also have an indirect import capability with 3D. Another new feature in the spreadsheet is our method of changing column widths. For instance, in the old method, if we wanted to change the width of column B, we'd go in, select columns, select a column, tell it column width, and now we could adjust it by pushing an OpenApple arrow. We may already know the length we want, for instance, 16. Now, simply type in the number 16, and there your column is formatted automatically to 16. Notice at the bottom of the screen, the third line from the bottom, says B1, and immediately following that, the word width. This is an indicator telling us the widths of our columns. Another feature of the AppleWorks 4.0 spreadsheet is Julian dates. The spreadsheet will take a number and put it into a date format. Now it's important to remember that the Julian date is simply a number and that the spreadsheet will treat it as it treats any other number. We simply use a different format. For example, let's type in the number 32,000. The spreadsheet says, okay, you've put 32,000 into cell A1. Now let's assign a new value format to it. We'll use the date format. We have 8 date display options. Let's pick the AppleWorks standard. Notice that this number is displayed now as August 12, 1991. To prove that it's still a number though, look at the bottom of your screen, the second line from the bottom. It still says 32,000. Similar to the database now, if we type in an aspirand followed by a return, it will plug in today's Julian date. Once again, notice the bottom of the screen, it's still a number. Go with me to column B. Notice these dates are also all numbers. We're going to consider these dates as inception dates of a loan. For instance, Abe Abel got his loan on the 15th of January of 1993. He had a $200 loan. Now what we want to find out is how old these loans are. We're a banker and we want to know who's paid up and who hasn't. What we need to do to determine that is to find out the number of days from his loan inception date from today's date, and we do that by a simple subtraction. Observe this formula in cell D5. It says if A1 minus B5, in other words, if today's date less the inception date is greater than the parameter listed above, the 30 that you see in D5, we want to display a blank. If it's less than the 30 days, that is, if it's anywhere below 30 days, we want to display it here. We've done a similar thing in every single one of these formulas. The result we're trying to drive at is to be to display only those days that fit the parameters in the particular column. For instance, let's look at this one. We say that this $450 is 60 days outstanding or less. His loan date was July 1st. Today is August 23. Well, that looks like less than 60 days, and hence it's displayed in column B. With this kind of information, we can make an aging. Okay, now we've found out that we made a mistake on Abe Abel's loan inception date. It was really the 20th and not the 15th. Since we don't have a real built-in feel for what the Julian date is, we have a method of converting a Gregorian date into a Julian date. What we do is put in a formula, and it's simply at and the name date, type in the year. The year we want was 1993. Type in the month, 1 for January, and the new date, 20 for the day. And notice it reevaluated it to January 20th, 1993. Don't forget the underlying value here is still a number, so we can use it in calculations further on inside the aging. Besides the date, there's a new value format for exponential notation. To get to it, simply go into the value formatting and ask for EXP, which stands for exponential. And sure enough, we have exponential notation. It'll also do numbers less than 1. Again, simply go into it, ask for it, but this time we're going to do something a little bit different. Let's ask for 3 decimal places. And sure enough, we have scientific notation. Notice this number that evaluates to a 12 with 102 zeros.